Hello friends, I Dr. Vinita, and we proceed to the Pathological Gait series 2. In this series, we will discuss anterior trunk bending gait, and the second one is the posterior trunk bending gait. In the anterior trunk bending gait, you see in the picture, there is a normal gait or normal walking of a person. You see that the axis or the line of gravity passes behind the knee or the knee joint, and in case of anterior trunk bending, it passes in front of the knee. Okay, what is the cause behind this? This is due to the quadriceps weakness combined with the weakness of the gluteus maximus and the gastrocnemius or both muscles. Okay, in anterior trunk bending, the subject flexes his or her trunk forward early in the stance phase. What is the stance phase? You studied in the gait cycle. In my first video of the gait, you see the gait cycle or different phases of the gait. In that stance phase, it's very important phase. Okay, 40% of the gait cycle, the stance phase. Okay, if only one leg is affected, if right leg is affected or either the left leg is affected, the trunk is straightened again around the time or around the opposite initial contact. But if both sides are affected, the trunk may be kept flexed throughout the gait cycle. So this is the difference between the one side affected or both side affected. If left only affected or right only affected, then the person flexes the trunk towards one side only. But if during stance phase only, okay, if both the leg are affected, both the leg are affected, then the throughout the cycle, gait cycle, person's trunk or the affected trunk may be kept flexed throughout the gait cycle. The gait abnormality is best seen from the side. In anterior trunk bending, the subject flexes his or her trunk forward early in the stance phase. If only one leg affected or right or left, you can see the example here, or both side affected, the throughout the gait cycle it will affect. Third point, this gait abnormality is best seen from the side. One important purpose of this gait pattern is to compensate for an inadequacy of the knee extensors. The line of action of the ground reaction force vector normally passes behind the axis of the knee. In past picture, we seen that, and the joint and generate an external movement which attempt to flex it. This is opposed by contraction of the quadriceps to generate an internal extension movement. If the quadriceps are weak or paralyzed, they cannot generate this internal movement and the knee will tend to collapse. Anterior trunk bending is used to move the center of gravity of the body forward. So we see in the picture that the line of gravity becomes in front of the knee joint. That's why in front of axis of the knee, producing an external extension or movement. In addition to anterior trunk bending, subject will sometime keep one hand on the affected thigh while walking to provide further stabilization for the knee. In posterior trunk bending, what are in the posterior trunk bending? These gait are like very, very easy to understand. One form of posterior trunk bending is essential a reverse version of the anterior trunk bending, you can say. In that early in the stance phase, in the anterior trunk bending, the whole trunk moves in the sagittal plane. But this time, this is the backward instead of forward. Again, it is most easily observed from the side. Both the gait are easily observed from the side. The purpose of this is to compensate for ineffective hip extensors. And ineffective hip extensors, you can see the line of the ground reaction force early in the stance phase normally passes in front of the hip joint. Again, I mentioned in the hip joint and passed in the anterior trunk bending, you see that the line of axis passes through the knee joint. This produces an external movement which attempt to flex the trunk forward on the thigh, opposed by contraction of the hip extensor, particularly the gluteus maximus muscle. Should these muscles be weak or paralyzed, the subject may compensate by moving the trunk backward at this time. Okay? And bringing the line of action of the external forces behind the axis of the hip joint. I think this is the perfect picture for you. You see that in normal condition, this is the position of the axis. But in condition of pathological gait or posterior trunk bending gait, this is the position of the axis. A different type of posterior trunk bending may occur early in the swing phase, where the subject may throw the trunk backward in order to propel the swinging leg forward. This is most often used to compensate for weakness of the hip flexors or spasticity of the hip extensors, either of which make it difficult to accelerate the femur forwards at the beginning of swing. This maneuver may also be used if the knee is unable to flex. Since the whole leg must be accelerated forward as one unit, which greatly increases the demand on the hip flexors. Posterior trunk bending may also occur when the hip is ankylosed or fused, the trunk moving backward as the thigh moves forward. In posterior trunk bending, you see the gluteus maximus or lurch gait, hip extensor weakness, knee ankylosis, spasticity, orthotic knee lock. This may be the condition for the posterior trunk bending and hip extensor spasticity. In this case, a different difference between the anterior or posterior is very, very, very easy, because in anterior you see that the flexion is forwarded and in posterior you see the flexion is backwarded. And one most easy is the knee and the hip distinguished. But in condition of the knee ankylosis, you have to differential diagnose the condition. Initial stage, you have to differential diagnose. But in later stage, you see the trunk bending, which is easily distinguished or easily you can see by physical appearance of the patient. And thank you for watching my video. And please comment and like, share my videos. Thank you so much.